The question of whether or not you should get a home battery seems to be quite a popular topic of conversation at the moment. There are loads of videos on YouTube about this, but none of them in my eyes really give you an answer. There's a very good reason for that, and it's because it depends on your own personal situation. So in this video, I'm going to go over what a home battery system can do for you and how you might be able to benefit from one. So a home battery system is pretty much what it sounds like, a battery for your home. If you found this video, then you probably already have a good idea what one is, but just in case, here's a quick overview. Home batteries are available from various manufacturers. You might have heard of the Tesla Powerwall, for example, and they are wired directly into your home's electrical system. The idea is that you can charge them up from the grid at cheaper off-peak times or from solar panels when it's sunny if you have them. Then outside of those times, they can provide your house with power. So they can save you money on your bills by reducing the amount of energy you consume from the grid at peak times, and they can extend your use of solar generated energy into the darker hours of the day. What size battery should you buy? Well, good question, and that really depends on how much energy you use, and more probably importantly, your budget. Let's pretend you have an unlimited budget for a minute. To work out how much storage capacity you might need, you want to start by taking a look at your energy bill. Your bill should tell you how much energy you have used and the time period that was over. So divide your total energy usage by the number of days and you should get an average value. Now, the problem with an average value is that it's an average. So some days you will have used less than that, some days more. So do you want to specify your battery capacity for an average day, or do you want to specify it for your worst days? There are pros and cons to both approaches. If you specify based on an average, then on some days you'll have to pay for peak energy when your batteries run out. But if you specify based on your worst days, then most of the time you will have unused capacity that you've paid for just sitting there doing nothing. Well, there are ways you can put that unused capacity to work, but that's a topic for later on in this video. To find out your worst days, you need to monitor your energy usage over a period of time. If you have a smart meter, then this is quite easy. Sign up with a free service to get the data from your smart meter. There are a few to choose from, such as Bright, Loop and Hugo. I'll put links to them in the description for you if you want to check them out. You can go through your usage and find your biggest usage days. Once you've decided on an energy figure, whether that's based on an average or worst case, you'll then want to add on about 10%. This is because there are overheads involved in converting energy from your grid or solar panels and putting it into the battery, and then taking it back out of the battery for you to use. 10% is a very rough finger in the air figure, because every single inverter and battery solution is different. Add that 10% to your figure and you get an answer to the question of what size battery should you buy. If your figure was 10 kilowatt hours, add on 10% to get 11 kilowatt hours, and that means you should be looking at getting a battery storage of at least 11 kilowatt hours. There's no hiding this fact, home batteries cost a lot of money. It's usually in the region of a few £1,000s, but it really does vary depending on the brand that you are choosing and the amount of storage capacity you need. You've already worked out how much capacity you need, so the next question is, can you afford it? Well, only get as much as you can afford, of course, but also get as much as you can afford. It will be a lot cheaper to get it all installed in one go than it would be to have your installers come back at a later date to increase the capacity. A lot of the cost, hopefully all of it, will actually be recouped in the form of bill savings. Eventually, it'll break even and those savings will turn into profit. Now, it will take a number of years for that to happen, anywhere between 5 and 10 years based on current energy prices and your individual use case. I've actually put together another video showing you how I am tracking and calculating the payback on my own battery and solar installation, so go and check that out if you'd like to learn how to calculate a return on investment. That's another point I need to make actually. You also need to decide if you're going to get solar panels installed at the same time or not. There are a couple of reasons for that. The first one being that solar panels and batteries go together really well. Batteries effectively turbocharge your solar panels by spreading their generated energy out into the darker hours. And secondly, at time of putting this video together, solar installations in the UK are exempt from VAT. If you have a battery installed at the same time as solar panels, then the battery is also VAT free. But if you just have a battery installed on its own, then you have to pay VAT, which can increase the cost quite a bit. That may change soon if it hasn't already by the time this video is published. And of course, if you already have solar panels, then you can still get a battery installed alongside them. There are many retrofit options available. Now, this is a very important topic, especially if you don't have solar panels, because if you are on a regular standard energy tariff that's the same all day, every day, then a battery will be of no advantage to you at all. In fact, it'll cost you money to run. You ideally need a tariff that gives you a reduced rate at certain times of the day. Now, back in the olden times, you could get an economy 7 meter installed, which would give you 7 hours of cheaper energy, usually overnight, but slightly increased rates for the rest of the day. You can still get that if you want to, but it's not usually the best value. I suggest getting a smart meter installed first if you haven't done that already. A smart meter opens up a whole world of energy tariffs to you, which are all based around the smart meter's ability to send your energy supplier meter readings every 30 minutes. Probably the most well-known energy supplier for innovative smart tariffs is Octopus Energy. There are other companies offering smart tariffs such as Eon Next and OVO Energy, but Octopus have loads to choose from, so there's bound to be one that suits your usage pattern the best. As a bonus, if you sign up using my referral code, which is on the screen right now, then we both get £50 of credit for free. So if you were considering signing up, then please use my code, as it really helps to keep the channel running. Anyway, there's a lot to talk about with tariffs, so I'll try and run through the options quickly. I guess that the most complicated tariff out there is Agile Octopus. With Agile, the price you pay for energy changes every half hour. So at peak times, this means you could be charged up to £1 per kilowatt hour. But if you're really lucky, then sometimes prices can go negative and you can be paid to use energy. Now, the thing with this tariff is it's not for beginners. You have to be really clever and flexible about when you use your energy to take advantage of it. Octopus do publish energy prices a day in advance, but you really need to keep a constant eye on them or use a home automation solution to do that for you. But I stress, this is not going to be for the majority of people. I'm purely mentioning this tariff because I get a lot of questions about it. Basically, unless you really know what you're doing with this tariff, steer clear of it because it could end up costing you a lot more money than you intended. Do you have an EV? If so, then you'll want to look at Octopus Go. It gives you 4 hours of cheap off-peak energy between 12:30 and 4:30 in the morning, so as you can charge your car. But you can also use those 4 hours to charge your home battery, heat your hot water, whatever you want. At the time of putting together this video, this is the tariff that I am personally using because we use a lot of energy to charge our car. It's also a really simple tariff to understand. 12:30 for 4 hours is cheap, the rest of the time is expensive, so cover it with your battery if you can. There is also an intelligent Octopus Go, which is a bit more complicated, but can save you even more money if you have a supported car or car charger. I don't have either at the moment, but if I did, then the idea is you get 6 fixed hours of off-peak energy every day between 11:30 in the evening and 5:30 in the morning. That can be used by your car or your home. But you have to let Octopus connect to your car or charger and control the charging times for you. You tell Octopus when you would like to use the car. It will then determine the best time slots to charge it for their own benefit. This means you could end up with additional cheap hours outside of those fixed 6 hours overnight. And those cheap rates would apply to anything your home uses too. If you have a car or a charger that supports the intelligent Octopus Go tariff, then this is quite likely to be the cheapest tariff for you. Do you have a heat pump or electric heating? Then Cozy Octopus might be a good tariff for you. This tariff has what they call a double dip. You get 6 hours of off-peak energy split into 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the afternoon, so as you can heat your home twice a day at a lower rate. But the catch is there's also an extra high peak rate between 4 and 7 p.m. So you could charge your home battery during those two off-peak periods to make sure that you can get through the super peak hours without drawing from the grid. Now, the Flux tariffs are designed especially for home battery owners. There's a 3 hour off-peak period every night, so as you can charge your battery, but there's also a 3 hour super peak period between 4 and 7 p.m. that you'll want your battery to cover for you. But that also applies to export rates. So if you have spare battery capacity, then you can dump that to the grid during the peak hours and get paid a premium for it. If you've got no EV and no electric heating, this tariff could be a good option for you. But wait, If you happen to have a compatible battery system, and at the time of making this video the only supported ones are from Give Energy, then you have the option of Intelligent Octopus Flux. This is similar to Intelligent Octopus Go in that you have to give Octopus full control over your battery. They will decide when best to charge it, and they'll do that at an off-peak rate. They'll also discharge it for you at a profitable peak rate. You effectively have to trust Octopus to manage it all for you, and they'll attempt to strike a balance between keeping the grid as green as possible and your bills as low as possible. So as you can see, you need to decide which tariff is best for your circumstances, and that depends on whether you have an EV, or if you have a heat pump, or if you are technically savvy enough to automate things based on Agile. At the very least, you can opt for the battery owner tariff called Flux. But now I want to discuss one more thing: power. A quick mansplain here before I begin, because a lot of people still get very confused between power and energy. Now, my description here is extremely simplified for the sake of helping to visualize it. Power, measured in watts, can be thought of as the speed at which you are using electricity. So your phone might charge at 20 watts, whereas an electric heater might demand 2000 watts of power. That power value is one moment in time. Think of it like being in a car. At any given moment, you are traveling at a particular speed. That speed can change constantly. Energy, on the other hand, considers time. How long was that power being drawn for? So in the car analogy, that would be the distance that you travelled in an hour. If you were travelling at 60 miles an hour in the car, you would cover more distance in an hour than you would at 30 miles an hour. So we tend to measure energy from electricity in kilowatt hours. If you were using a 1 kilowatt heater for 1 hour, then you would have used 1 kilowatt hour of energy. So why is this important to understand when it comes to home batteries? Well, it's because home batteries need inverters. Inverters convert the DC power from your battery into AC power that you can use in your home, and they can only do that at certain speeds or power outputs. Now, most battery inverters tend to have a power output of 3.68 kilowatts. This means that it can supply your home with power so long as you're not drawing more than 3.68 kilowatts. If your home goes over that limit, let's say you put on the oven, the kettle, the microwave all at the same time, then the excess will be drawn from the grid. If that only happens occasionally for you, then it's probably not going to cost you much. But if it's a regular thing, then you need to consider an inverter with an appropriate power output. You can get inverters with an output of 5, 6, 7 kilowatts, and you can even in some cases string together multiple inverters to get really high outputs. Look, I know there's been a lot of detail here to think about, so I'm going to try and summarise it. How much energy do you use? Use this to work out how much battery capacity you require. How much can you afford? Is it worthwhile getting solar panels at the same time? Get a smart meter installed and move onto a smart tariff suitable for your circumstances. Choose a battery inverter with enough power output to support your needs. Hopefully, if you've considered all of those points, then you'll be in an informed position to start contacting installers and avoid any disappointment from misconceptions about the technologies involved. Home batteries really can benefit the majority of households, but it's making sure that you're using them correctly which gives you those benefits. Unfortunately, the majority of installers are just not set up to provide long-term help and advice on the optimum usage of your battery. I guess it would be a bit like expecting John Lewis to keep checking in on your cookery skills after they've sold you an oven. So you really do need to be as informed as possible and ready to put in a bit of effort when investing in a battery. Anyway, I hope you found this useful. If you did, then please give the video a like and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more from me too. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.